I don't know if you remember at the start of this evening, we watched a little video clip from the soccer. It was 2006 World Cup when Australia defeated Japan. And if you don't remember it, Japan went up 1-0 after 26 minutes. But with just 6 minutes to go in regular time, it looked like it was all over, right? It looked like we were out. But Tim Cahill steps up, doesn't he? Scores the equaliser. And then still with 2 minutes left to go, he scores another one. And then just the icing on the cake, stoppage time, Eliza steps up and scores another goal. And take the win, 3-1. Well, how about this one? Remember this, maybe back 2010 cricket, 2020. Semi-final, Australia coming up against Pakistan. Pakistan having scored a mammoth 191 runs were then favourites, right? And the pressure from such a massive score resulted in Australia being reduced to 7 for 144 to 17, sorry, the 18th over. But Mike Hussey steps to the plate, takes on responsibility, and he needs, when it comes to the crease, he needs 48 runs off 17 balls. So a superhuman effort required. You know what's going to happen. I mean, Australia require 18 from the last over. Johnson's on strike. Takes a single on the first ball. Good lad. Gets Hussey on strike. 6-6-4-6. You win. You take the win. Take the win and stun Pakistan and enter into the finals. Amazing, right? And we love it. We've seen a few over this week, great escape stories, and we've seen a couple just there, amazing stories. And I wonder if you can kind of think of some similar sporting experiences. Because we all like it, I can see by your response even just now, everyone likes a sporting club like that. Especially if it's your team, and it's your team that comes back to the wins. Because there's so much emotion involved, right? Because there's a sense of grief and sadness as the clock ticks and you realise that there's no chance that your team can come back from defeat. So you kind of resign yourself, it's all over. And then suddenly out of nowhere, maybe a flash of brilliance by an individual player or something just happens and something sparks and then some little hope comes. And then before you know it, everyone's celebrating in the midst of this joy of an incredible victory. And tonight, that's what we're looking at. We're looking at the risen rescuer. We're looking at the greatest escape story of all time. Forget about those sporting stories. This is the greatest escape story of all time. And over the week, we've journeyed through this, haven't we? We've journeyed through it. We've seen how Jesus heals a crippled man, raises a dead man to life. And we've seen that the disciples have been disciples, Jesus' closest followers. They've been following him for about 3 years and they've heard phenomenal teaching about God's kingdom. They've seen incredible miracles. They've had crowds following them. If there's social media at the time, it would be going off. But what's more, the disciples, those that have been closest to Jesus, those that are around him, are starting to see that this Jesus is God. But then, Jesus is killed. And the disciples, they're relegated to shock, confusion, grief, as they process that Jesus is dead. He's been crucified. He's been crucified. He's been killed by the Romans using torture that was safe for criminals. And these Romans, they were, at the time, they were ruthless. They were expert killers. After crucifixion, the criminals were often left and left either on the cross, just to leave there for a while, or left unburied as well, or they were just chucked in a nearby field. But in our story tonight, we look at chapter 23, verse 52. We read about this man, Joseph, and he courageously approached this guy, Pilate, who was in charge of Jesus being put on the cross, and he asked for Jesus' body, he asked to be able to give Jesus a proper burial. And then if you look at verse 55 here in your Bibles, you see on the screen, the women at the time, as per tradition at the time, they returned to the tomb. They returned with spices and perfumes to prepare the body to be buried. And that's a bit like today. If you're not too sure, it's a bit like when we go to a funeral these days, we take our flowers and we lay respect, show respect for the dead, and that's what we were doing. So in our story tonight, it's clear that Pilate, Joseph, and the women, they acknowledge that Jesus is dead. So take yourself there again. Can you imagine how the disciples felt, how his followers felt? And then, what a turnaround, eh? What a turnaround. What a great escape. They arrive at the tomb, there's no sign of the body. And just as we started the week, there were angels giving the shepherds an announcement. Now, the angels appear and they announce this. Let's read it all together. Chapter 24, verse 5 to 7. So the next one. Next one up. So I should say why, if you've got your Bibles out, you can join in with me. It's a good little text. Why do you look for the living among the dead? Okay, let's read that together. I'll start getting to it. All together. Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He is risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee. The Son of Man has been delivered into the hands of sinful men. He crucified on the third day and raised again. So it's a bit like our sporting comeback stories at the start tonight. Now the disciples hear that Jesus is alive. And I wonder what your response would be to that news. I wonder what you would be feeling at the time. Maybe you would be like the women. Maybe you were just like, let's go and see. They realize straight away that Jesus is alive, and I now want to go and share that news. So the women in verse 10. Or maybe you're a bit like the men in verse 11, but that straight away they think this is all a load of nonsense. What are you talking about? Or maybe you're a bit like Peter, and you head to verify the news for yourself. You rush down to the tomb and just check, is Jesus' body there or not? And that's my question now. I wonder what your response this week has been to Jesus. I wonder if you believe the evidence that Jesus rose from the dead. Or you think it's nonsense. Or maybe you're in a place where you're like, oh, things are a load of rubbish. But now you're like, hang on a minute, there's something going on here. You just want to take a bit more time to dig in and explore what really happened in Jesus' life. Now there's good evidence, there's good, solid, historical evidence that Jesus rose from the dead. There's plenty of rationale to be able to say, look, this is not a crazy thing to believe that Jesus rose from the dead. You can also look around at your leaders this week, and I'm sure other people, other athletes in the world, who have realized that Jesus is alive. And you can look to them as well. But I'm not for tonight. We're not going to look at the evidence of Jesus rising from the dead. Something again, I can just leave for you guys to discuss maybe in your huddle groups. But I want to focus tonight as we come to a close. That what is the significance of Jesus rising from the dead? Why is Jesus' resurrection? Why is that your greatest escape story? It's not just the greatest escape story. It's your greatest escape. So let's go a little snapshots through the week to try and answer that question. Why is this your greatest escape story? Now if you remember on Monday night, we read the account of a crippled man being healed by Jesus. So this crippled man was brought to Jesus, but before healing him, Jesus says this. He says, friend, would you say your sins are forgiven? So what is sin? Let's go back to our definition. If you remember, we had on the other day. Sin is missing the point that God created us, and so we end up living life without recognizing that He made us. So it's turning from God, it's choosing to ignore that God made us. And from our story of the crippled man, we saw that Jesus sees that our sin is the greatest problem, and our forgiveness of that sin is our greatest need, so that we can restore the relationship with God. And that's for you as well. Tonight, your greatest need. The greatest need is a restored relationship with God. And remember, that's what we found out. If you don't have that, it's a sobering reality. That separation from God, that's God's, as the Bible uses the word wrath, it's God's righteous anger. It results in the end of death. And that's what we've got to come to again. The result of your sin, the consequence of your sin tonight, his death. Now we move through, and Rob took us through on Tuesday night, that the logical consequence of turning from the one who created us, who gave us life, the logical consequence of turning from the very one who gave us life, is the existence of death, right? Like we say, ultimately sin results in death. But when we saw in that event, what did we see? We saw a dead man raised to life. Jesus raised a dead man to life. And Jesus showed that he was willing and able to deal with the consequences of sin. And he brings the dead man to life again. But I don't know if you've thought of this during the week. In that account, Jesus only dealt with death in this one person, this one young man's life. Because that man would later go on and die again. But that's what we got to last night. Thankfully, we heard last night that on the cross, Jesus was dealing with the sin of every person for every time. He was taking on God's wrath, taking on God's anger at our betrayal. See, like Herman said last night, they were pointing at him and saying, why don't you come down and save yourself? But if Jesus had just died on the cross, if he hadn't died on the cross and just finished there, it would have been a bit like Jesus with the crippled man. You see, he told the crippled man that his sins are forgiven, but he didn't actually prove it at the time. But then he proved that, you remember that logic? He proved that he was able to heal this man's sin. By then, what did he do? He was able to walk again, and that was the time to prove, to say, look, what I said is backed up by my actions. But if we go back to the cross, Jesus just died on the cross and it finished there. We hear this story of Jesus being crucified. We know that he was dealing with the sin in the world for all time, but we wouldn't have any proof that he achieved what he set out to. Like other gurus in the world, gurus of other religions across time, Jesus would have been known in history just as a good moral teacher who ended up dying. But by dying and raising to life, Jesus provides ultimate proof that he is God. Ultimate proof that he's defeated death, defeated sin and its consequences. That's what we're going to celebrate tonight. See, Jesus, fully man, fully God, by rising from the dead, has proven that he has power over sin and death. And this gives us incredible assurance for our lives, guys. It means that we can live now without fear of death. We can live without fear of separation from God. We can live without fear of hell. Instead, we know that Jesus is providing the way forward for us into eternity. So the Bible says there'll be a new heaven and a new earth. Yes, it will be joyful there, incredibly joyful times when he returns, and there's a new heaven and a new earth. But don't miss the moment, there's incredible joy now. See, because when Jesus died on the cross, what he did on that cross, and by rising again, he's brought us to this incredible place of joy. Because now we can live life, you can live all that you have, close to God, no longer far from him. Guys, we've come from an incredible escape, and I hope we got hold of that tonight. Incredible escape. Unfortunately, there are still consequences, though, in our world at this time. Rick uploaded at the moment. I did have a quick flip on what's going on in the world today, the news, and simply look at that, you're like, hang on, we're still in a broken world. Not just in our sport, but in larger life. There's still injury, there's still cheating, there's still abuse of power, there's still illness, there's still broken families. But this is the resurrection, this is what it brings. And it says, in spite of this, we can live with great joy. We can live with great joy because we know that Jesus already has a victory. It's a bit like going into a race, knowing that you've already won. Yeah, you still have to run the race, you still have to get through it. But you know the victory is yours, and that can spur you on when things get tough. You know that Jesus has already provided the way forward for you, and that brings that ultimate joy and incredible. Guys, what an incredible escape, guys. This is what we're going to celebrate tonight. We can get excited about the end of the camp, we can get music on, playing, and it's great, so much fun. But this is the greatest escape story of all time. It's the greatest escape story of all time. Don't miss that this week. Nothing better than it. Each of us deserves punishment for turning to God. Yet he chooses to take the punishment that we deserve on himself. You might hear that again and again. But it is incredible. If you dwell on that, if you come back to that, there is such relief. You should just be able to take a big breath and go, wow. Incredible joy. We've heard this week about the greatest escape story of all time, guys. That is what we're going to get excited about tonight. That's what we're going to praise about with singing in a bit. But before we do, if you haven't got to that point yet, that's okay. If you haven't got to that point where you're still maybe liking the story, you saw that Peter had to rush down and have a look. That's okay. You've got time now. You've got time even today and tomorrow to speak to your leaders. You've got time to go away and process it, ponder, read more. You've got your Bibles on the table with you. But if you have got to the point this week that you have come to this point to realize that Jesus, what he has done for you is incredible, you've got an opportunity tonight to make it your greatest escape story. Not just a story over there that we've looked at, but you get to step into it tonight and it becomes real for you. And that's where we're going to go now. That's why I'm going to challenge you really now. Like, if you've come to realize this week that God has shown you incredible love for you by dying on the cross, by taking your sin, by being in that spot in place of you, if you come to realize this week that Jesus is alive, I wonder what your response is going to be tonight. I encourage you, I urge you, remember that word from the verse, I urge you to take a step tonight. Herman talked a bit about it last night and touched on it. He said, when you get this idea of great joy, there's also this sense of underlying, he used the word sadness, or this underlying sense of, I guess, gratitude. You feel like, I guess, the word is a debt of love. You can't do anything to repay what God has paid you, but there's a sense that something massive has been done for you, and there's, I can't do anything to repay him for it, but I want to keep showing appreciation. And that's where we come back to our memory verse. Hopefully here it all comes together. Do you know what he says? Let's read it out. Let's actually leave it off, because I know you will know it. What does it say? Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. So, his word urged, if you've got it this week, if you get that Jesus has died for your sin, he's risen again for your sin, if you get it, what do you do? What does Paul say? He says, I urge you, brothers and sisters, to give your whole life for him, to surrender your life, to give up your life, and say, okay, you've died for me, I'm going to give my whole life to you. And remember, that's what he learned this week. We're going to pray in a minute. You've got an opportunity to pray and give your life to God right now. If you've not done so before, and you feel that you've thought about it this week, and you've got, okay, now's the time for me to respond to what Jesus has done for me. Remember this verse, though. It says, I urge you to live your lives as a living sacrifice. If you pray tonight, it's the start. It's the start of your whole life. Your leaders can attest to that, and lots of you as young athletes can attest to that. It's every day coming back to that Jesus is alive. You experience it in an incredible way here at Sports Plus. So we've all been thinking about it all week. But it means that for the rest of your life, you live your sport, your school, your career, whatever you're going to do, it's shaped by what Christ has done. So I'm going to give you an opportunity now to respond. I'm going to pray in a minute. And I'm just going to read you the prayer before we actually pray. Okay?